We greet you all, our friends, our listeners, and also our enemies as well. We say Shabbat Shalom on this great Shabbatont, that we may rest in the abundance of His great riches, His Oshir. We may be happy abundantly above the definitive of being happy. Yahshua paid the price just for us. What a great rewards. And I'm here just because of Him. And so we greet you all, our friends, and you that have been concerned concerning our welfare, you that have volunteered to come to assist in the labor. We do Birach Yah for your great kindness. We want to inform you all that all is well. We received a call from a precious daughter there in London. It's amazing that he gives me a true Marshall Miller. And she calls to say, Raah, we are so concerned. Her husband calls. And to speak of the abundance of the great blessings that they have accumulated by listening, being a part of this order of Shekha, that we come before Him to honor Him. And so they call with great concern of our welfare. She called, he called, she emailed us to try to find out our welfare, our well-being. We want you all to know that everything is well with us. We had those who call as far away as Chicago, Arkansas, they were concerned about our welfare. Everything escaped us, or we escaped. No, I don't want to use that terminology, because the rain was welcome, much needed here. Nearly 9 inches, 8+ inches, and we needed that. I was talking to one, I said, it is a great blessing that Yah planted us here in this, what they call the worthless soil of South Carolina. It is called sandy loam. It has no nutritional value for crops. And so he did not put us in the midst of the clay belts just across the state line, whereby there is no dispersing of the water, because we got a lot of water. In places whereby the strongness of the clay, houses and bridges built upon that, but it must yield to Yah. And so the loam yields and absorbs and allows the free flow of water to the depths of the limestone, that it may flow into the rivers and the bodies of water. And so I do Barach Yah for that. I did not want the sand when we first came here. Now, in all of my ignorance, I understand. Well, you can grow better in clay. Well, Yah has blessed us to grow foods and to nourish ourselves from the garden. So I am pleased with Him. What a great time, great season. The feast days are over. Great anticipation to the next one. I live for the feast days. I look forward to them. So immediately after Sukkah, the last great day, I began to prepare to make sure that everything is accommodating for the house of Yisrael, above all that, to make sure that I am one that is in right standings and the right order with Yah. We are a generation that will not police ourselves, not judge ourselves. We are incapable of doing that. And so Yah would always set the shoftim over Yisrael. And as long as they were alive, they would repudiate them and show them the stench, the corruption of their sadistic evil ways. And as soon as they died, they went back to their ways, to their corruption. And so when the word, the Torah of Yah, has no life in you, you revert back to your ways. You don't even know you're in the ways that are so corrupt, vile, sadistically evil, until it has finished its course, and then death is upon us. I said to my Ishaw this morning, I said, it seemed as though that it has been some time before I stood before the people. She said, I wanted to ask you last night, Shabbat evening, what was you going to teach? That is her first time ever saying that to me. I said, baby girl, honestly, I did not know until I awakened this morning. Then I began to look into the depths of the Torah. Yeah. And then it all came to fruition. Yeah. So there is not some preparatory process that I take, but I do prepare. Yeah. And prepare my mind and my life constantly and continuously. Yeah. That I may be a vessel of truth. And I don't speak in hypocrisy and duplicity. But I speak from the mind of Yahshua HaMashiach. And so I responded to her to a degree. It was what I took from the great gathering of Yah's people. As our Zochin Yarameyah, he read this verse in the closing of Gadol Yam Cha, the last great day. And as the old ones would say, it reads like this. What manner of saying is this that he said? You're going to seek me. You're going to darash. You're going to, with all of your effort, your essence, your heart, you're going to seek me. He said, and you shall not. Lo, there is no possibility that you shall find me. And he said, where I am going and the place that is prepared. He said, you cannot go. You cannot come. You cannot enter in. We must come in at the door. You're not even ready. Your mind is not even open unto Torah. Then he opened their understanding. He opened their understanding to Hitzvi, scripture. The reason why, because they were dead in the trespasses of their sins and they trespassed the Torah of Yah. Then it identifies the time that he was in. It says, in the last day, Acharit, the very end, the conclusion, the determination, the finality, that great day, the Gadol of the Moed, of the feast, Sukkah. Yeshua cried, and he said unto the people, he uttered, Amma, with great sensitivity, great wisdom, he uttered unto the people, if any man thirsts, let him come, enter in me, and then drink from the well of life, from the living water. I am that living water. He says that he that has great confidence, he that declares the Omein of Yah, that it is firm, a confirmation. It is of Emunah to believe this. And it is steadfast. And it is stable. He that believes, Omein, like Kitzve, like that Katuv that I'm reading now, has said, he declares out of that man, out of his belly, his betam, the life that flows in him, the resources to nourish, shall flow the living waters of Yah. And as our Zokain brought out, you will understand the power of the living waters. From Tehillim 1, Psalms 1, read the whole chapter. You will understand that kind of a man, that person. And so as I reflect today over what has transpired, the conclusion of the Moads, have I grown? Have I taken advantage of all of the nourishment, the nutrients, the speech, the teaching, the preaching, the exhortation, the admonishment, the rebuke, the correction? And so if I have received that, then it will catapult me, cause me to grow exponentially. And as I wait for Yah's year to begin at Pesach, then all of that which needs to be planted, it is already sprouted. And so I can simply plant that. And then when Shavuot comes, when Pentecost comes, I began to harvest the first fruits. I began to claim the fruit of the labor of Yahshua HaMashiach. There's no power for me to do anything of myself. But I can do, I can fashion, I can accomplish all things, call everything through Yahshua HaMashiach. And he is my uzzah. He is the strength of my confidence. He did it all for me. I have no compunction with one saying he did it all for me. He did it just for you and you and you. He did it for me. And so I will not renounce that and cast it aside as though it has no value. And so this morning as I sat in the early hours waiting for the daylight to approach, and so I let my blind up so that I can see out. Akmikaya said to me the other day concerning my office, you know, Raah, I believe it was he or Zach and Yaakov, that a person would not even appreciate the simplicity of this office. I said, I do need a blind. One day I'll get one. I'm too lazy to buy one. And I can see the honesty of your speech because I sit here and I look. And so I informed him what I'm teaching from here. I have to let that one blind all the way up because it is so raggy. I don't want that to be seen. Things mean nothing to me. They have no value because I'm going to have to walk out of this earth one day. And so the summation of all that was concluded here during the feast, the words that's pronounced in my life with great satisfaction, that there must be a final determination. Not only that, Yisrael, there is a finishing line. The final determination of the finishing line. And I want to continue in the vein that last verse that Zachin Yeremiah brought out to us on the last great day, as Yahshua uttered, that I can find from the mouth of the Nobi the same utterance that is parallel or give parative to what Yahshua said. And in my search in Torah, I found it in the hidden treasures of the book. It is found in 4th Ezra. 4th Ezra chapter 2 and verse 38. He expressed unto us the identity of the true signs, or the true Moed, or the feast days of Yah. And then he gives us an illustration that when one really understands the dynamic and the purpose of this, then there's a final result. And he begins this disclosure here in 4th Ezra, in chapter 2 and verse 38. He tells us to come, to rise, Yah expressed the word kum. He is talking about that the volume fills every empty space. We must let Yahshua HaMashiach arise in our levim. That it fills, the testimony fills all the voidness and all the juvenile speculation and ways in our minds that are non-productive. He says, arise up. He said, you all need to stand. When we've done all that we can do to stand with all of our resolve, then we must stand. We cannot be wavered. We cannot give up or give in. He says, and look or behold at, he is talking about the feast, the feast of Yah, and the number of those, and the number of those are zoking so deliberately, indelibly, trying to impart that, implant that in our minds. He gave us the pattern, the tasnith, of this Moed and the purpose of it. I say things that we disregard. I have watched over the years at Pesah, those have always left after Pesah because at this time of the season he marked them. And there are no fruits, or there is no floration or no budding of fruit in their lives, and he knows to take them from Pesah to Shavuot. They're not going to bring forth fruit. That's a fact. He said, I want you, Ezra, you messengers, to number those that have been chatan, that have been sealed, that have the true seal of Yah. We don't understand that in this day that he seals the minds of his people. We must understand what that seal is. We must understand how the seal comes and what are the elements whereby must be in that vessel for one to be sealed. He said, I want you to make sure that the number of those that have been sealed. Now those are the words of Ezra. Chapter 2, 38, 4th Ezra. Now that is what I'm going to teach from. What is the seal? In whom? Who are those that are sealed? We're going to maintain from the book of Ezra. But I want to direct our attention to Ephesians. Shaul says here, as you write unto those that are at Ephesus, they were dearly beloved of him. And he speaks out of first out of Ephesus chapter 1 and verse 13. He speaks with such emphasizing of the great seal of Almighty Yah. First chapter of Ephesians chapter 1 verse 13. He talks about us in whom you that also trusted. That is the first element that must be in us. This is a generation that does not trust. We also, we both talk. Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 13. We have, first of all, we must trust. First of all, you must trust, and you do not understand the application of trust until after you have shemak, the word of truth. You must hear the word of truth. You must hear the word of truth. He said you trust it after Ephesians 1 and 13. He said after you heard, after you shemach, after you heard what? The words or the word of truth. There's a comma mark there. Also, that is in great association with the word of truth. He said the bizarach, or the message of your Yahshua, of your great deliverance, of your bounding, your abundance, of the shackles being broken. You must, first of all, Yisrael, you must trust that message of truth that breaks the shackles of your mind, this is a generation that trusts no one. You cannot hear this unless he sends the Melech, the messenger. You trust it. After what you had heard, the message of the profound witness of the Navim, the prophets of the Torah, he says, and also the great Bezerach, or the message of your salvation, in whom also after, see, you must hear that, you believed. He said, only then you believed, then you were sealed. Then you were sealed. Then you were sealed. I know that our conscience and our minds are seared with the hot iron of our sins. And the power of our ability to hear and to believe, yeah, the message of the power of his dynamics, is difficult for us to do that. That's why I say this. I say this to your warning and the warnings of others. I have watched over all the years. I have seen them after the Moed, the feast days of Pesach, the beginning of Yah's new year. I've seen them. I've watched them in their disgruntled wickedness. And they have blamed everyone for their damnable sins. You understand? I don't blame the soil for what things have become impertinent in our soil that it doesn't produce. I blame me. And I blame those that I simply ask, help me. Could you not watch this for a moment? Like Yahshua HaMashiach said, you couldn't even watch for me with 1 hour and pray. You can't stroll through the greenhouse of the garden and see what is taking place. And to scratch your head and say that there are certain amenities or additives that are needed. Come on. That's our lives. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of waters, and his fruit, or the tree, shall bring forth its fruit in due season. They uproot themselves from the water of Yah. They find their own deceit of treachery, their beguile ways, and it takes them down into the delusion of hell. You can pray for them. I will not pray for them. I pray not for them, Yahshua said. I pray for the ones that Yah calls to hear the teaching of his truth and to allow it to bear in their heart. And you can see fruit in there at that. We are sealed. Only then we are sealed, he says, with the Ruach HaKodesh of what? Of promise. That is the only sure seal. And those are the elements that must be in us. You will know that one has the power of the Ruach when one deals in truth. You will know when you hear their speech, it is a confidence in Yah. You will know that one trusts in the message of Yahshua HaMashiach. You will know that that is a treasure unto them, because they prize their Yahshua when their minds are so deluded and so vile and so filthy after the great day of Yah. You know that is a mind that is damnable, damned to hell. And there is nothing you're going to do to rectify the course of that damnable, wicked mind. I won't try it. I will not. You can. So this is what I got. All right. He said to those that were here, men, don't tell me you love me. You're going to stand by me. Because the first thing the enemy is going to do is try you. Your sons, your daughters, your children, your wives, your husbands. Through those that you meet here, you don't even know them. You never knew them until you met me. And they buy your lies. And they lie to them. Woe unto you that you lie unto one and speak lies and speak falsehood. You're going to pay. I'm going to teach and hallow a little bit today and preach. Ezra says in the next verse, verse 39, I want you to hear this. It's vitally important that you hear it. 4th Ezra, chapter 2, verse 39. He said, I want you to understand those who have departed from the shadows of death of this age. We must depart from the shadow of death. We must not embrace the defiance of the Torah of Yah, fellowship in the depths of sin. When we see this great beauty of this last time that we are in, we must prepare our minds to meet our great Maker. And then he says here, and they have received now, they have received, it has been no fun granted unto them, they have received the magnificent, beautiful, he calls it lebouche, the garment. That's what the last great day is about, that you receive the garment. So when you walk out of the gathering, everybody can see your light and your garment. Isn't that what a woman does, a man that thinks that he or she is dressed appropriately for the occasion? They want people to acknowledge their garments, do they not? They want others to see their garments and see how they're dressed. So they can look at them and say, you're so beautiful. You look, you got swagger, man. They have put on the magnificent garment, the garments from Yah. Well, to understand the magnificent garments of Yah, what I must put on, I'm not going to deal with what I must take off. I'm going to deal with what we must put on. We should have gotten up this Shabbat or the day after the last great day, and we dress ourselves, our minds accordingly to this book. Well, what do I put on? I want to begin here. In the writings of the prophet Isaiah, Yeshua. Writings of the prophet of Isaiah, that he expressed unto us as a nation of people. There is something that supersedes even this kingdom. There is one that shall come. He shall establish the melchut, the kingdom of Yah in our hearts. When we are poor, we're satisfied. When we're in agony, we're satisfied. When death surrounds us, we are satisfied because we know where our assurance rests. So he brings us to the gathering. We haven't seen one for years. We may not see them again after that. So he commands us as he lays out before us the garments. When one is really participating in an event, that they want the specter of their beauty to be seen, their dress, they lay it out. I said this morning to myself, I feel somewhat sober this morning. So I want to put on black. That's the first time I've ever said that. I don't think about what I'm going to wear. I go there and I say, okay, I can wear that. But for some reason, I wanted the maturity of my speech to represent the blackness even of our sins and our ways that refutes and reject Yah. The prophet says in Isaiah chapter 52 verse 1, he commands us to awaken, awaken, arise out of your slumber and your sleep. And then first of all, he tells us, Isaiah chapter 52 verse 1, he said, I want you to first of all put on Yisrael. I want you to put on the Uzzah, the Koach, the strength. We must put on the strength of Yah. We must stop allowing our little juvenile, immature ways to take such gravitational pull over our emotions that we don't even act like adults. We don't even act like children. So first of all, we need to put on strength. We're reminded during the teachings, even the words of Dawid, he that is poor say I'm rich. You that are weak say I am strong. So you put that resolution in your mind, Israel. He commands us to put on. These are the magnificent, one of them, the magnificent garment of Yah. We must first of all put on strength, O Sion. Are we not Zion? Is not our mind the dwelling place of the Ruach? We've been sealed because we trust and we believe. He commands us to put on strength. He identifies us as Sion, O Zion. He commands us to put on our kanat, our tefillah, our yafef. Put on. He says, your beautiful garment, O Yerushalayim. Well, who is Yerushalayim? Who makes up that city? They that walks in the covenant and the teaching of shalom. So this is shalom to us today. This is not an aversion. This not does not take us away from truth. So we that are in our mother, which is from above, Yerushalayim, then we as a nation, we must put on the garment. We must put on. Put on every kind of despicable, damnable garment that we put on, the garment of lies and deceit and murmuring and complaining. We don't put on the beautiful garments of Yah. We don't put on the strength and the power of the testimony of Yahshua. That's why we're walking like dead men on our way to hell. He said, I want you to put on, O Yerushalayim, the Kodesh city. For henceforth, he says, from this day, from the last great day, he says, from henceforth, there shall no more come into you that which is aral. You don't allow those uncircumcised things to penetrate your mind. You don't listen to the wicked and the way of the world and allow them to fill your mind with lies and all kind of vileness. You listen to the uncircumcised dog, like that we said to the great one, the king, or the Philistine, the thought that he was bad and bona fide. He called him a dog. You uncircumcised beast, you may be Goliath, and you may stand in the vast power of your strength, but I come to you in the name of my great Abaya. We should not allow the uncircumcised, the Arad. What is an Arad thought or words that are spoken by the wicked? They don't make you get closer to Yah. They don't examine your wicked heart. They don't show you your damnable vile ways. He said, in the city of Yerushalayim, no uncircumcised is going to come in there. Look at this. He said, and neither will the torment the unclean things. We don't allow those unclean things. We don't allow the unclean things to come into our minds. We don't allow those words that are unclean to me. They're filthy. They're nidah, like a rag that comes off a woman doing her administration. It is of no value. And those words don't solidify the strength of Yahshua's testimony. It tends to dismantle a little bit at a time, to draw you away from faith, to draw you away from Yisrael, to draw you away from that which is right. And you become engulfed in that. You enwrapped by the folly and the foolishness of your own damnable ways. And Yah sends you one just like you to show you how vile, how evil, how sadistic, and how wicked you are. You can't go into Yerushalayim that way. I don't care if it's your mammy, your grandpappy, your sons, your daughter. It makes me no different. This is what I got, all right? He commands us to awaken at our sleep, O ye drunken, as Yoel said, concerning the last days. Awaken, awaken out of your sleep, you drunkards. You become so inebriated in your sins and your corruption. You don't even know how to see clearly. That's why you will amplify the motes of your eye. You don't see the damnable sin of corruption in you. That's why we're sick, we're dying, and we're going to die. I don't care if you don't love me. I don't care if you never give me an offering. I don't need an offering. He did it all for me. No, he did it all for me. He did it all for me. Well, I'm going to bring this home. Nobody's going to escape. He commands us to awaken. He proceeds to give us instructions to the writing of the book. And there's a place found, as the old preacher would say, there in Isaiah chapter 59, verse 17. He gives us an identity of the garments of Yah. He tells us what the garments are. Yes. Isaiah chapter 59 and verse 17. He talks about the power of this kingdom that is in us. He identifies Yahshua here. He says, for he, for Yahshua, this is what he did. Yahshua put on the tzedakah. He put on righteousness. You think we're going to put on lies and escape? That's the precious garment of Yah that he allows you to dress in his state of his being, whom he is, his personality, his identity. You got to put that on. We get up and we put on lies and deceit and every kind of damnable folly. I don't like liars. I don't like liars. If there's anything that turns me away from a person, that is a liar. For he, Yahshua, shall put on the tzedakah, the righteousness. He's going to put that on as a shirion, a breastplate. We must put on the same garment. We're commanded to do. He shall put on his breast, his shirt, shall be filled with the righteousness of the Torah. We do things by association, friendship. We don't do things according to Yah's will. He shall put on the shirion, this body armor. It protects everything. You got on a breastplate when you're righteous. I don't care what the enemy does, what he says. I don't care about the accusations. Nothing offends you. It does not bring you down. It does not destroy you. He shall put on this great breastplate, and he's going to put on the kabah. He's going to put on this great helmet, his rush. Yahshua is your rush man. Yahshua is your rush man. He is your helmet. He is the helmet of your assurance. He shall put on the helmet of his Yahshua. We rise up with him on our mind. We go to sleep with him on our mind. We get up mad with him on our mind. He is our mind that a righteous law operates in my house. I don't give a damn what wives say. I don't care how children behave. You don't codify the wickedness of wife or children. You don't sue the wife for either wickedness or her sins. You command by rebuke. Where are the men today? We don't have any. Well, don't tell nobody. No, you come before the altar, and then you confess your sins, you wicked Jezebel, you little weak boy. Find someone else that you like. Don't listen to me. And he puts on the garment of what? Nacha. He puts on the garment of vengeance. We shall avenge the sins in our hearts that took advantage of us. We shall do it with vengeance. How wicked I am. I don't care who gets up here and talk about the tub of Yah. I'm guilty of everything. Every kind of adulterous, wicked, deceitful, violent, evil act, I'm guilty. You hypocrites don't have to. I am. That's why as a man, I would say, hallelujah. Oh, yeah, you found me. I couldn't hide under nothing. And we are men. We don't give a damn about expressing the greatness of his connection with us. We set that moment like someone that has no damn sense. Yet folly and frivolity, you laugh, you talk. You're like a jackass of a clown. I don't care if you don't say amen to me. He's pleased with me. He's satisfied with me. How do you know I can't talk like this? I couldn't talk like this if I was full of deceit, lies, and corruption. You're not getting by. I don't want to get by. I want to get in. I want to get in. And I have only witnessed one witness that true, that exemplates or express my truth to Yah, and he gives me a wife to love her, to order my house right, to be kind and to care for her like Yahshua HaMashiach loved the church. You can talk that bull all you want to. You can say, oh man, I love you, Rayaka. It doesn't mean nothing to Yah. He gives me a wife. Show me how to live honorably, to love her. You don't coddle her lies and her corruption. You do that, you don't give a damn about her. You don't correct her, you don't give a damn. You don't bruise her. I will not do that to you. Will not, never have. Your mind is my mind. Hallelujah. He shall put on the garment of vengeance. That's what he says. We don't revenge the sin against Yahshua. We watch those that reproach your wicked sons. I got a wicked brother. I don't even let him touch me. I give him some bump. That's a fact. See, I can lie and say I don't. My wife has been with me too many times. 90% of the time when I see him, she's with me. He comes out, I don't embrace him, give him some bump. Oh, boom! You give credence to your wicked sons and daughters. There are folks, even when they're about to die, they'll call a wicked horse daughter or son. They won't say, call the man of Yah. If any there's anyone sick among you, let him call for the elders. That's what you're supposed to do, call for the man of Yah. Come, messenger, come. Let me get your daughter, your grandyoungers over here. They're wicked. I don't give a damn if you don't love me. I don't care who you are. I don't care how, I'm going to use those words. I don't care how you feel toward me. And they hear your last breath of a call. No, get the messenger. Get the man of Yah. I want to make sure that I'm right. That's how wicked we are. You see, I'm not going to daughter live with duplicity. I'm not a hypocrite. If there's anything, you will never be able to charge me with a hypocrite and a liar, a false brother. You could say he's ignorant. I don't mind. I'm not offended. But I'm not a liar. I don't do things undercover either. I'm open. You can hide, but you're not hiding. Let me proceed. This is what I came away with from the feast. Hallelujah. He says we shall put on the garment of vengeance for clothing, and then we shall be clad with the kinnah of the zeal as a cloak. That we're so jealous to defend Yorkshire, we don't care if mama gets in the way, we allow his vengeance to come. We have the kinnah, the jealousy. I'm not going to let you corrupt my HaMashiach. I'm not going to let your vileness, I don't care if you're my mama, my son, my daughter, I don't care who you are, I'm not going to allow you to do this. We don't want nobody to tell us how wrong we are. We justify our wickedness and our evil ways. That's why we are sick and many are asleep and many are dead, because we have taken this lechem, this bread, inappropriately, and we covet. You know what? I say this all the time. We will covet those that we think we have connection with. But we don't love the messengers of Yah that reproves our sins and reveal the depth of our own depravity and our wickedness of our heart. We don't love them. You're not going to speak accolades of approval unto him, but you will do it with a nasty grandbaby. She dressed like a dirty whore. He tells us to put on the garments of magnificent. Put on strength. And then there's one thing, my cloak, I'm covered with the zeal of the kinnah. I'm jealous over him. I'm jealous of his love. I'm jealous of the love of Yah. For whom the Father loveth, he correcteth. I want him to correct me. He doesn't give a damn about you. He doesn't correct you. He doesn't reveal your hidden secret wicked ways because he doesn't give a damn. You can carry them in your damnable wicked heart, but when that finished, you're going to die. Won't be no love for y'all. You won't have no light. You're wicked, and yet you call me wicked. You're a wicked man, and you call me wicked. You're a wicked daughter, but you will say she's wicked or she's wicked. Now you're the wicked one. You hide it because it's my personal assessment of that. No. I want to show us something. This is where we got to put it. Can I preach a little bit as though folks will say, can I preach? I shall. Hallelujah. I want to tell us something. We must all wear the same clothing. Well, why do you say that? Well, Shaul says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 24. He commands us, Ephesians chapter 4, 24, and that we put on. We must clothe ourselves, put on the renewed man. What man is that? That renewed man, which is after Yahshua. We must put on that man. I can't put on the name David that was birthed out of my mother's loins. I must put on Yahshua HaMashiach. I must put on his tzedakah. I must put on his personal qualities and his personality. We must put on that man. I can't put on the man David that looks after his own treacherous, evil, sadistic ways and guard them from the exposure of the word of Yah. I must cast that man aside, which is created. Look now, it says, I read in Yeshaya that the first thing that Yahshua put on, Isaiah 59:17, and he put on Sadat, did he not? He put on righteousness. Shaul says, we shall put on this man that which we're renewed in after Yahshua is created in the Sadiq, and they admit the truth and the set apartness of Almighty Yah. We must put that on. Those are our garments. We must be set apart. There's a woman that called me. Many times I don't answer the telephone. I see where the call is coming from. She says to me, very beautiful spirit. She says, Riak, such agony on me. Do you all pray for people? I said, well, certainly we do, ma'am. I don't mind praying for you. I like Ruach, the genuineness of her, conveyancy of her heart. She says, first of all, pray for my family. I was just yesterday. Pray for my husband. Pray for my grandchildren, all of that. I said to her, what if the will of Yah is that he takes them down the road of error to destroy him, to prove to you in the final resolve that there will be hatred in us that is so pure against that which defiled Yahshua that we can understand the depth of Yah. I said, I tell you what, daughter, I will pray the will of Yah be done with your family. And I said, who is your family anyway? Who are those that you really love? She didn't fight me back. Are you trying to destroy families? Hell, there are no families that is of any strength. They get together to eat pork chops and chicken and lie and laugh and clown like jackasses. In the midst of the most turbulent moments, they clown like jackasses. Even when death, they're laughing with damn folly and telling jokes and lies. You think when someone dies, they're sober, quiet? They're drinking and becoming drunk like a pack of jackasses. You don't hear no one says, let's get on our face. You daughters get in the prayer room and you pray. You pray an hour. You too, you get in there and pray an hour. And around the clock there's prayer. They're drinking. They're lying like damn dogs. You might as well come on and concur with me. You don't find them even as a nation should. That when one die, you bury them that day. And you have 7 days of mourning that you know that everything Yah has done is perfect. They drink and they get drunk. And they lie and they take inappropriate actions. I will not be a part of it. I'm not going to your funeral. Last one I went to his grandmother's. I said, I won't go to another one. Unless I'm preaching. We will take them right to the graveyard. Hallelujah. So that's not a time of great fearfulness and soberness. Go to the house, she's laying on the bed with her last breath dying. I love you, Dad. I love you, Mom. And goes right in the living room. They act like jackasses, clowning. But you don't love me, but you love them. You love him, you love her, but you don't love me. I'm wrong, he's wrong, she's wrong, but they're not wrong. I got you today. You might as well love me. It makes no difference whether you love me or not. Hallelujah. Listen to this. We must put on the renewed man, which is in the image of Yahshua HaMashiach, Ephesians 4:24. That we must be set apart, and that he also says in Ephesians 6:11, we must put on the whole armor. 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 We must put on the whole armor of Yah, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of Hashatan. You got to have the breastplate on. You got to have your loins girded about with truth. You have to be honest. You have to tell the truth all the time. You have to be direct. You can't be false. We must have our feet shod with the preparation of this Mizorach of peace. When the wicked come in the midst, your words draw them away. It's not your damn folly that draws them to you. It's your words that cause them to run and segregate. I don't give a damn if it's your daddy or your grandpappy. Give it your grandmommy. Give us your brother, your sister, runs them. Your heart is not yet right with Yah. I'll be back. Okay, you go ahead. We must put on the whole armor of Yah. That's why we don't stand against the encroachment of hell. We allow the trickery of hell to bring us, seduce us to do that which is against Yah. And we cover sin with sin. We cover sin, we covet it. And that's a fact. I didn't know I was going to say this, but that's all right. It's needed for you. I didn't know I was going to say this. This is not the direction I wanted to go, but that's all right. We got to plow up this ground. It's fallow ground. Our hearts are hearts. And they're hard from lies and deception of your own damn wicked ways. I haven't deceived you. Show me one deception I've taught you. Show me how I've deceived you. Please tell me. I haven't deceived you to lie and to do things in a skullduggery way. I haven't done that. You see, you're such a deceitful liar. You don't trust me. You don't trust nobody. You're not even honest enough to trust anyone. That's a wicked man. I don't give a damn who you are. You can see my life. She has nothing against me she can use to say, he's doing this. He doesn't know how to talk to me. He's done that. You can't say it. You cannot. He loves money. He got money hid. If I told you all the orphans that came in and where it went, I say, yeah, all of that money, I really can't even account for it. Mother, I'll just tell you one, you two. There was one ark he gave $1,000. Well, I gave away $1,200 just from that. So $200 had to come from somewhere. I could have kept every dime. And it was all cash. I'm not dishonest. When I gave $1,200, I bought a hot water system for that house. The little juvenile camera that we have, it wasn't worth it. And so we bought a camera system that will work efficiently for us here. That's where that one went. The only one I have left is what one brother gave, he and his Ishaw, his family. I just haven't cashed the checks. I'll put that in the bank. But that's meant too. I could have kept every bit of it. There was one brother sent $2,000. I said to Akmikaya, we would have had $200 left when I paid the electric bill. I was so happy. I didn't take one dime of the money. I didn't keep back 10%. $200? No. I took every dime, paid the electric bill, took care of a few things, and we spent money in food. He went out with me the other night just for that last day meal. How much was that, Akmikaya? How much? How much? $500 when you round it off. It was more than $500, Akmikaya. Don't forget now, we stopped that. Talk to me, man. Talk to me. Just in coffee, because I knew that those are like it, and cream. That was $60. I don't have to hide. I'm going to preach you today. I got the will to preach, daughter. Paul writing unto Colossians, hear this now. This is what he tells us here. We must have imagery. We must have the image of Yeshua. He says in Colossians 3:10, and have put on, he said, I put on the renewed man, which is renewed in the knowledge, the da'at, after the image of him, who, Yah, that created. He is the one that made Yeshua HaMashiach. We must have the image of Almighty Yahweh. We must have this righteous Torah in us. We must love our neighbors as we love ourselves. And if my daughter, my son, my children, my grandmother is not my neighbor, I'm going to love my neighbor as myself. I give you the commandments of Yah. I will never do that, rebuke you. And I know that my life is not right. I can't teach things that I know I'm not walking circumspect of. All I'm saying, we must do what's right. I want to be a strong man. Lead us into the battle. Brother said, you're going to send me a 45 or 44 Magnum. He says, powerful. I said, I tell you what, I'm going to send you a video clip. Now, believe me, I'll be able to handle it. How much are the bullets? He said, 100. I said, whoa, nah, I don't know about that. You don't take that and just do target practice. I don't have no $100. I know you're listening, so send me some ammo too if you've got some extra. That's an offering. The young ones, all of them get a percentage of that. They will not be upset. I want to keep our mind attuned into this book, Yisra'ya'e. I'm not here for no frivolity, no folly, anything like that. We must be renewed in the knowledge, the da'at, the ability to discern and to understand the depth of this truth. We're renewed one daily. I'm renewed every day. My heart, before I left the house, I was working on a teaching, Rehoboam and the now generation of the Hebrew Israelites. I'm going to teach that. My mind is constantly being renewed daily and all during the day because this is what renewed me daily, constantly, consistently. We must be renewed. And when we're renewed in that mind, that's the way we live. We live in this regard of mutuality of my love for you. I know it's the same as for me. As my love mature for you, you sense the power and the gravity of that. And not only that, then you're able to forbear me. You're able to forgive me. You're able to grab, lock arms with me and say, let us go ahead together. We put on some dirty stuff. We left tabernacle with dirty clothes on. Dirty mind. Let's read this in Colossians, same chapter. Chapter 3, I want to drop down to verse 12. He commands us to put on, therefore, as we are the bochir, the elect of Yah. Are we not the elect? I am. He said you must put on first of all, kadosh, kodash, set apart, and beloved, that's who we are. We must put on, first of all, we must have bowels of compassion and pity. We have bowels of compassion with the world, but not Yah's people. We forbear them. We forgive them. They can treat us like dogs. We run to them and licking up their pilk. But when it's one of the house of Yisra'iyah, we're asinine. We reject them. We keep that in our minds year after year. What one did was so minute that we cannot forget it. And that's the truth. You watch mothers where sons curse them out. Mothers where their sons will beat them up. And their sons will kill them out and they will say in love for him. Just like that lady in Tennessee when her son shut down that cup. She said that he was with me. She lied. Everybody could see that that was their man. And mothers will lie for their daughters and their sons. But yet we won't stand in defense for Yisra'el. Brothers will stand up for natural brothers. And they will cast aside a true brother for a wicked whoremonger, a liar. Daddies will embrace, love, and mamas their wicked daughters and sons. And they know they're filthy. They do not embrace Yisra'el because their heart is fallow. Their heart, they hate Yah. You say what you want to. I'm going to prove it. Does he say take off or put on, therefore? He said, put on therefore the elect. He's talking about just a specific group of people. He said, let as the elect of Yah. He said, you must make sure that you are Kodesh and you have a great Ahavabila, bowels of compassion. You must have pity. You must show kindness to the nation. What child thinks that mother, father, when they spank them, that they are kind? See, when we truly become in tune with Yah, he corrects us, Musa. He chastened us, he put the rod on us. See, we would not say that's kind. Yet if the messenger reprove our sins, we'd always say he's not kind. He's not humble. He tells us to put on the humbleness of mind. I'm nothing. As the old folk would say, if it had not been for you all my sight, where would I be? I believe that. Where would you be? Your damn wicked son or your daughter is not going to save you from death. How wicked can our minds get? I don't want them to kiss me. I didn't let my mother do it. You all think I'm cold. I knew she was my mother. I said, this is what kind of regard you have for me. And you know, old woman, that I don't like that tobacco and all that. And you call. I said, no, I'm not going to let you do it. Now, when you got to the point, you couldn't chew it. And now I will kiss you. How about that? Now, I will give you a kiss, but I will not let her kiss me. I put my hand. No, you're not going to do that. I'm not going to let you do it. Because I said to her, you need to stop that. She's going to defy that correction and say, I'll just kiss you. Well, you're not going to kiss me. My mother smoked those cigarettes. I didn't embrace her. You can. I won't. Hallelujah. I'm not going to embrace them. We must have meekness. We don't fight their. Young men and women, they fight everything because of their own sin. Well, I don't take correction well. Then you're a fool. If you correct a fool, you're going to get a blot. You correct a wise daughter, a wise son, they will love you great. Your daughters out there, they don't take correction well. You are a fool. I don't care who you are. You can send $100,000. I will still tell you, you are a wicked fool. Correct a wise man. He will love you. Correct a wise daughter. She will say, bless you, mother. Bless you, papa. You correct a fool, you're going to get your blot. They will hate you. That's what the word says. And he tells us to be long-suffering. Remember, that was a situation many years ago. My Imrafe says, I'm sick of her. That's it. I said, that's all right. They need you. Stand by her side. That's all right. You can endure that. And I've seen the results of that. I've seen the results of it. She said, I'm weary. So you haven't done anything. You got that one thing, I got this whole thing. We must be long-suffering. Then he says this in verse 13, forbearing one another. This is what we must put on. He began here, put on, therefore, as elect. Is there not a colon, a semicolon down there at verse 13? Is this not a compound sentence here? 3:12? So that tells you there are other elements to the sentence, right? Does it not tell you that? That's what it tells you, doesn't it? There's more to this one thing. He said, forbearing one another and forgiving one another. If any man has an opposition or a quarrel with against another, semicolon, even as Mashiach forgave you, you also forgive them. I don't care what the situation is. You forgive them. There are those that remember things that happened 10 years ago, even here. They hold it in their wicked hearts. You can't hold nothing righteous. With that kind of opposition, that's why we're dying. We're sick, and our minds are sick. We hold this trash in us. You got to clean yourself out, Yisrael. That's why we had that day of great Kippur of Atonement, to cleanse your mind out. That's what the process of fasting is. I had to clean me out just because to get ready for tabernacle. Because I would have put on 10 pounds if I had eaten everything. The cake and cereal. I just, Papa, let me get you some of this. This is just so tough. You want a piece? You want some iced tea? That was my first time drinking that sweetened iced tea. I said, I'm going to do it again, yeah. Maybe Pesach next year I drink some. You want some of this? Papi, let me prepare your plate. Papi, you want some? I'll go get it. Sarah, get away from me. No. Big old slices of cake and they just, How do you turn that down? You can't. See, if I ate one piece, I'd have been eating in the sukkah. You understand? I ate another piece and another piece. Oh, that's me. Because it's tough. I did get me two of those biscuits that the daughter made. I like those thin. They are the perfect biscuits. We all got a biscuit maker here. Just let her make the biscuits. They're biscuits I love. Thin. You can't make a sandwich with the biscuits. Right. I don't like thick biscuits. Take all the goo out. Give me a thin biscuit. I'm going to eat a biscuit. Give me a thin one. Hallelujah. We must put on these things. Verse 14, he says, and above all, and above all, and above all, this is the final destination of determination. This is the finished course. We'll get to that. He says, and above all the things that I've told you to put on, above all these things, that's plural, isn't it? T-H-I-N-G-S. Yeah. He said, put on the great love of your Ahava, which is the bond. See, we don't walk in the perfection. That is what bonds everything together, love. That's what bonds it all together, love. He set before us one of the most prime examples. Me as a man to love my wife. Me as a man to love my wife. As Yorkshire, no, not like another man loved his wife, like Yorkshire loved the assembly. That's the only way I can love her that way. That's the only way I can love her that way. That's the only way I can love is the way that Yorkshire loved the assembly. Yeah. He laid that as life for us. Hallelujah. Without the bond of love, that is the bond that perfects, that brings everything into operation. Without the pure love of Yah, without you loving the nation, you are a hypocrite. You're full of hypocrisy. You love lies and vile and evil things you purported. You will uphold that. But now, I don't give a damn if you get upset with me. I don't care if you get mad. It's your beastly nature that caused you to get mad. It's your wickedness because undoubtedly it's cutting you. And he's trying to show you you're going to die. See, I tell us all the time, the way you are, that's the way you're going to die. We don't buy that. You don't believe what I say. You don't believe me. Yehuda Iscariot was a son of perdition from day one. He died that way, didn't he? And everyone that has been born, the seal is on them. Kill her. Kill that Jezebel. That's all she is. He's not mine. He's not worth a damn. That one is mine now. He's weak. She doesn't have this kind of personality. I know. That one is mine. And the way you resist Yah's truth today, that's the way you're going to die. That's the way you're going to die. You get upset with me, a man that tells you the truth. You get angry because you know it's you. And you get upset with me. You ought to revenge. That's why we must put on the garment of vengeance. You have to revenge that evil in your heart. Say, you wicked dog, you are. I am. You're trying to take me into the dungeons of the gullies of hell. That's what you should say. And rebuke you. Yet you'll rebuke me. Don't write me your email letters, all right? You're not going to straighten me out. You're not going to tell me what to say or what to do, all right? Hallelujah. 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 He says, and above all these, put on a hava, which is the bond of your tomim of perfection. And then he said, when you've done that, let the shalom of Yah rule in your levim. What? To the which also you'll call into one body. And then he said, I want you to show out the yada, the hudu, the great praises of Yah, that you'll be thankful. Yeah. Then he says this. He said, we must let the word of Yeshua HaMashiach dwell in us, what, richly? That's the Esher. We must let it dwell in us richly. Do you hear that? Yeah. When you got rich organic soil, you don't have to worry about too many weeds. It's something that they don't like, that kind of soil. When the soil is rich with all the nutrients, our soil out here is not rich. When you look at garden for us, not rich. That's why the weeds grow there. When you go down here, weeds will grow anywhere. Corrupt things will come up out of anything. But when your mind is pure, your thoughts on Yah, every thought and imagination that exalts itself against Yah, you cast it down to the graveyard of hell. So when a mind is rich, it grows rich. And you grow richly. He said, let it dwell in you richly. Well, how? In all wisdom. And when we have that wisdom of Yah, this is what it will do. Teaching, and admonishing. What is that admonishment? Stop, boy. And Shibuya said, boy, I said stop. He don't, boy, I said stop like me. Boy, I told you to stop. He put it on my little friend there one day. I said, man, better me. That was the wrong man. I shouldn't have asked him. Raah, that's... Joseph, stop! See, that's an admonishment. He will think before he does that. He knows that eyes are on him. That makes him to be the purveyor of knowledge. He's got knowledge behind that. I said, stop, man! No, that's enough. Man, that's what I told the mama to do it. I don't want you to do it, man. No, I saw you. I'm going to call you. I told the mama. She goes and tell him. I didn't want him. I wanted her. That's why Yah doesn't deal with us, as we remind, after the seeing of the eyes and the hearing of the ears. But he deals with us according through Yahshua HaMashiach. So he's dealing with us today, telling, don't denounce Yahshua. You better let this word dwell in you richly, in all wisdom, rich in the richness of wisdom, teaching and admonishing one another. You teach each other and you admonish them. Even in the Tehillim, in the Psalms, and in Hallel praises, and spiritual songs. So folks get mad when you start singing. They upset with you. I thank Yahweh for saving me. They get mad. Why is she singing? And they try to make noise, so they want to hear that. So when you start talking about the excellence of Yah, they want to start. They're not talking now, but they want to start up a conversation about nothing, about foolishness and sin. You know they're wicked as hell, because they're being admonished just by the righteous words of the songs of others. All of a sudden, you're quiet as they come, and all of a sudden, you want to start talking now. You got something you want to say. You want to talk to this one or that one. And then you want to act silly. I know it's right. I'm glad that this preacher is preaching to me today. See, I didn't even know I was going to say that. That's for you. And they're singing in the unmerited favor of Yah, great Ahava, in our Elohim. And we sing to the Master Yahshua. Don't tell me, I've seen it too many times. I've seen it when I'm talking, then these fools, they want to start talking. Now, y'all stop that. You got a testimony, testify. You want to sing a song, let's sing. But they'll start talking about things that are so silly and so foolish. So immature. That's not even important. That's why your conclaves of sin, you don't talk about Yah. You talk about sin. When you gather with those, I don't care who you talk about. I don't care your mam-in-law, your pap-in-law. I don't care who it is. You all don't talk about Yahshua. You talk about silliness. You eat and clown and act like jackasses. That's what we do. That's why I'm not a part of their fellowships. You don't talk about Yah. You can say what you want to. What on the bed in the dining, they out there clowning and acting like fools, laughing and, you know. Yeah. You don't talk about him because he's not the fullness of your heart. Yeah. You have no songs in you. That's why you can't sing. In my days as a young lad, I remember this, Zach, and you're older than me, but you know, I could see the old ones come across the field. And they will get there in the house in their long skirts and their aprons and their bonnets on. And Miss Cutting Coran was sick or laying on the bed. And we'll get saying, oh, come, yeah, yeah, oh, come, yeah. Mm-hmm. They sat there quietly. And when one talked, they whisper, tell me, oh woman, talk to me. They sat. I said to my friend, I said, Akmikaya, I can remember things so vividly as a child. I wasn't being nosy, but I could see things far greater with clarity than young boys my age. And I would look at things like that, and you would say, oh, yeah, we need you. And they would sit there, and would she get tired? Yeah, we need, oh, we need you, we need you to heal up by love, we need you, yeah. And when one had to use the restroom, they didn't have no bathroom, they go out to the... That's how they did it. And as a little boy, I would just watch and look at that. Such soberness. Am I telling the truth? It's not something I've watched on YouTube. I know from experience. I can't remember everything. I can't remember everything I did last week. Neither can you. But those things that were impregnated in my mind, I can remember that. It was no folly, no foolishness, no clowningness. You understand? There were those that they wouldn't even let come in to see. Baby, hold up now. Oh, no, 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 no. You just wait out here. That's a fact. Is that what you're doing? Okay. They wouldn't let you in. Yeah, my mama. No, 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 no. Hold up. Whoa. Big daddy would hold up, boy. You's been going, you done your thing, your dirty stuff. Then mama, you broke her heart. Right? You's going out there. You's wait here. You's wait. No, 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 boy. You's wait here. You's wait here for her. Now, I said, the boy don't. This is a wicked generation. They had more strength than we have. They have more righteousness than we have today. We have the ultimate of strength, Yeshua. The testimony, I don't care who it is. I know I'm telling the truth. You do too. Church of God in Christ, folks didn't just let any money. They had sense back then. They were a lot cleaner than these faggots and freaks today. Marrying. It's amazing. I said to myself, yes, I said, it's amazing that these dogs call themselves bulldaggers. That's what they're, bull. They're not even bulls. When they call themselves getting married, there's only one identity as the one that has the dominant spirit, what they call the man. You know how they identify that one? She got on some pants and she got on a vest like a man in a bow tie and she's going to wear a fedora. That's how you know. And the other one wears a dress. So you women walking around like bulldaggers, take off your wicked pants. Is that how they identify? Sure it is. I've seen that. I don't even read trash like that. I wouldn't dare waste y'all's precious time to read something like that. But you see the pictures everywhere. They inundate the world with that today. You know the man. She got on her white pantsuit, her tuxedo, and the other one got on a white gown. These filthy dogs out of hell. And so that's how you identify the one that's playing the man's role. She got on pants. Stop wearing the pants, daughters. It's an abomination. It's vile. It's filthy. Come out of your wicked pants. You're going to die that way. Y'all hates it. And that's a fact. And I don't care if you don't love me. You don't even love you. So how can you love me? Hallelujah. We must sing of the great. We must put on the singing of Yah. We must sing the songs of Hallel. We must rejoice in the blessings of Yahshua. We must let it be known. Hallelujah. And that's a fact. In the place of death, you're singing. In the place of death, you're singing. You got the preacher man on. I want to hear the preacher. Put him on. It's amazing you can hear today. I don't care where you are. He was at the hospital. He heard me. So you can't hear it. You let the room be filled with that. Doubt listening to Michael Jackson or some folly that frivolity. I don't want to doubt that. We're moving quickly here. I want you, Yisrael, as the personality of Yahshua is, was, we must have that. There was no one that spoke so with a vivid account, although before the coming of Yahshua, as Shlomo did here in the book of Wisdom. Wisdom, the Chukmah, chapter 5, verse 18. Hear this. You all jot it down, the book of Wisdom 5, 18. It says that Yahshua shall put on. Now you hear that? He shall put on the Sadaka. This was before Yeshaya, Isaiah, ever spoke. Shlomo said he's going to put on righteousness as a breastplate. And this is the most important thing. He's going to put on true, impartial judgment. Now, is my judgment impartial? Is your judgment impartial? You judge me with such severity. You don't judge that daughter with that severity. You don't judge your son, your grandchildren. You don't judge your wife like that. You rebuke me, but you don't straighten your wife out. You don't straighten your son out. You rebuke me, woman, but you don't live worth a damn that your husband can see the beauty of the promise of Yahshua in you. We must put all impartial judgment. We're impartial to those that we love. All this came this morning. It didn't come during the week, all this. See, we must. You shall put on. He says that. Put on. Righteousness as a breastplate. You should be so righteous that when people see you, they will know that you're not going to judge impartially. You should put on impartial judgment and justice instead of a helmet. You're going to be Yahshua. You're going to do things straight and honestly. Because your head is Yahshua. This is Yahshua because his head is Yah. And we don't have to worry about my head being covered. Yahshua got my head. As they were saying in the world, I got you covered, baby. I got your back. No, I got your head, what Yahshua says. He says, and he shall take Kodesh. He shall be set apart for an invincible shield. When we are righteous, when we are set apart, nobody can penetrate our stratosphere. He shall take that as a shield. It's not the shield of faith. We need the invincible shield because our faith, it breaks, it's shattered. We break down, we denounce, we deny, we forget. But when you got on the righteousness and you set apart the Kodesh nature of Yahshua, you got an invincible shield. It is able to take all the wiles of the hell of darkness. And it says, and his severe wrath shall he sharpen his sword. He's going to take vengeance on everything that opposes Yah. That's what I sharpen my sword with those that diametrically oppose Yah and do things that are evil, sadistic, and very wickedly. And they pretend that's a hypocrite. You don't pretend. You do righteously. You don't pretend. This is what the book says. These are not my opinions. This is not my judgment. This is what the book says. His severe wrath shall be sharpened for a sword. And the world shall fight with him. We that of Yah, we're going to fight with him against the unwise. We're not going to have a separate standard for me than you. It's the same. No different. I'm not going to eat steak every day and give you beans and rice. No, we eat beans and rice. You eat beans and rice. You're not going to eat what I eat. You need something for them trees. I'm weaker. You can't have impartial judgment. You judge her wrong with severity, but yet she does things that are worse. And you uphold her ways, but you condemn her. That's evil, son. She is as wicked as they come in my house. Then I condemn your wife because I'm a juvenile coward. I have no strength in my home to say, you Jezebel, sit down and shut your wicked mouth. But I will find a little moat your wife down because she has lied to me on her. Then I will condemn her. That's a wicked dog. That's not even a wicked dog. That's not even a man. Uphold her wickedness. And she has not done anything nearly as severe as she has. And I condemn her. I won't do it. And she condemns her. I won't let her do it. I'm not that weak. I'm weak, but I say I'm strong because of this truth. This is what I took from all the food I ate this week. We must continue in the battle until the end. We must maintain the imunah. See, you can't even put on the right things. You got to, first of all, believe what I'm preaching. And then you begin to put on the garments, and even your faces will become beautiful. You rejoice and you sing to your heart and say, I'm so glad I got over. Oh, I look back and I say, I got over. I didn't. Oh, the preacher preached to me. He cut my stony heart. He revealed all of my sins that nobody knew about them. Come on, Yisrael. Hallelujah. What he says, we're going to fight against the unwise because we love young. What has happened, we're not putting on the garments of righteousness. We're putting on the garments of the world. A profound prophecy out of the mouth of Hanukkah. Hear this. Please hear me today. Please hear me. I'm not here. I can't destroy you. You destroy yourself. When sin is finished, it brings forth death. I can't kill you. I warn you. I speak the words of warning to warn us. Yah is not planned. Just like the day, the second just changed from one second to the other. He doesn't change that way. Be not deceived. Yah is not mocked. For what we sow, we're going to reap. We can't do things under the cover of our own deceit. Because if I did that to us, I will sell you all out for a lie. I will sell you out to protect my own sins and my wickedness. We don't understand that because we deal so deceitfully and so dishonest with each other. We don't understand that. We think that nobody lives like that and nobody's that genuine and nobody's that sincere because you're not sincere. The prophet Hanukkah says in Hanukkah, he tells us about this day. He tells us what will take place, the order of things, and what kind of indulgence we will walk in. Hanukkah, Enoch 98:1. He says, as the Melech speaks to him, now swear unto you, I'm telling you, to the wise and to the foolish. He's speaking to you that are wise, and you that are evil, you that are unwise, and you're evil, and you're full of your sins. For you shall see many things upon the earth. That those that battle against what they call gay marriages and all of this filth. And they don't know Yah. He said this was going to happen. He says, for your young men shall put on more jewelry than the women. Is that not so? They got every kind of colored band and every kind of neck scarf and every kind of colored thing and every kind of ring on every finger. Talk to me, Yisrael. They got every kind of earbob in every earlobe in their nose and their tongues and their mouth. For the young men shall put on more jewelry than the women. He says, and they're going to put on more multicolored garments. In my days, you wore certain colors. I'm not about to wear no pink suit now. No, I'm not about to wear that. That was an adoring of a man and adoring of a woman. He said they're going to put on multiple colors, more multiple ornaments than a virgin. The virgin wore one that was a Bethulah. She wore clothing that signified where men, just like the harlot had her garments. They're going to have one more garments than a virgin, than a Bethulah. In sovereignty, in grandeur, nobody's going to tell them anything. They're going to think they're fine. When they got little faggots like Will Smith's son wearing dresses and skirts and saying that for the black man, he's breaking this stereotype of what manhood is. That's a little faggot. He's a punk. He wears more multicolors than the Little whores that he called himself dating. He's only about, what, 16, 17? I don't know how old the little faggot is. He's experienced more things than a man 60 years old. They're going to stand in their own sovereignty, their grandeur, and in their own authority. They're going to wear their silver, their bling bling. They got on their gold and clothing, and they're going to honor themselves. And in the edibles, they shall be poured out like water. He gives us this confirmation. He said, for this reason, they are devoid. They are devoid of knowledge and wisdom, so they shall perish thereby, together with their things, their goods, and together, and with all of what they call splendor and honor, then in dishonor, in slaughter, and in great misery, their spirit shall be cast away. So I warn us. See how they dress? You dress in your arrogance, your haughty ways, your defiance. He's talking to me. Well, sure, I'm talking to you. I had no intention to come here and talk to you, but I'm talking to you now. I'm talking to you. That's why no man's going to be able to trust in a friend or anyone. Because if I'm dishonest with you today, I'm going to be dishonest in the time of great agony. I'm going to lie to you. If you're dishonest with me today in such great times, we have eaten so well. I still like those thin biscuits. I like them. We got any left? I don't need them, but I may have me a pan made of them. I like them thin biscuits. They're going to die in their misery. We won't be able to trust each other, because if I can't trust you now, son, I'm not going to speculate about you. There was one here that I knew he was dirty. I knew he was doing wicked stuff. I knew that. But I said, I'll forbear. You understand? I knew he was wicked. I knew he was unclean. I knew he didn't want to hear me. No, I told that person to leave. I don't want you anymore. Well, he's nice. You don't even know what nice is. They will beguile you. That's how the enemy beguiled Chava. I didn't want him here, because I was sick of him. I was sick of his evil ways. I was sick of that person that didn't give a damn about nobody, not even me. Because if he did, he would not have done me the way he did. That's all right. I'm all right. I don't hope, lady, I will kill your dog. You're not going to kill him. I said, well, let him bite me, ma'am. I will kill it. I will kick his head in. Let him bite me. The only thing you need to do is put it on a leash. And that kind of strong rebuke, she wasn't angry at me. She said, well, I think I'll go put a leash on him. I said, thank you kindly, ma'am. And so when I left to let her know, I have no hard feelings toward you, lady. How you doing? She didn't go. She said, and she smiles at me because I smiled at her. Not her, but her. I'm not playing with this evil generation. It will rob you of everything. Yeshua said that. Father will be against son, son against father, mother against daughter, daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. I don't know how stupid we are. This man reminds us all the time that we are the light of the world. We lose our light. We lose our Yahshak, then we lose our light. Huh? We are the city that's set upon a hill. He reminds us now, the few that be that find it. Broad and wide is the gate that leads to destruction. He tells us all the time. I'm not exempt from that. He's not exempt from that. He must live more exemplary than those worse than he expects you to live. He's not exempt from that. And if you think he's exempt, that he does things or we can do things that disqualify that I'm more evil than the most evil one that I think is evil. We do it right all the time. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So the men shall put on Don't we see them putting on that today? They're putting on their arrogance. They're putting on their corruption, the devious deeds and their vile actions. They're putting that on, are they not? We must put on the Siddiq of Yah. That's what this feast should have done, the day of Kippurah that we fast, to identify our ways. He didn't give us but 5 days to get it right. If he gave us 5 days to make sure we come in clean, you think he's going to give you 5 years to get it right? No, today is the your shock to salvation of Yah. You better get it right today. When you wake up tomorrow, get it right. You got aught against Yisrael, you go and get it right with them. I watched these devils that had aught against people, and they left, and they still got the same altar. And they think that you think I'm going to embrace you when I see you? You will die like a dog. You don't have to worry about me. I walk right past you. It's amazing, my friend. People that knew nothing about each other, but through me, they become the best of friends. When you don't care for me, you think that you're going to care for. People are crazy. Well, she's my friend. She's not your friend. She's prowling into your business and nosy. She's trying to find out and search out your secrets and the ways of God. She doesn't give a damn about you. He doesn't care about you. I will. I'm not going to mistrust him because of what others have done. He's been with me all these years as a young son, as an equal brother, as a tenacious basketball player. I like that. I just can't do it no more. I'm not going to forsake him. I'm not going to let someone come in here. I'm going to push him and say, I'm not going to do that. Because he's proven himself. You're proving yourselves. I'm not going to do that. I'm not going to do it. You can, but I won't do it. I'm not going to complain about him to strangers. Yet people have complained about each other to strangers. You don't have to tell me. I know us. And the thinking of this vile generation, you will complain to strangers. You will lie for your own wickedness. But I'm here to tell you, my friend, you're going to have to pay for it. That's me and that's you. You're not getting by. You may think judgment is not expediently, because Yah doesn't correct you expediently, because he doesn't tell you your sins, then the heart is fully set, and your heart is set against Yah to do wickedly. That's what our heart do, because you're not judged immediately. You're not corrected. Then you set your motions, you do that which is wicked. You defy the righteousness of Yah. You're wrong, my friend. You're not going to get by. I don't care who you are. I'm not going to get by. That's my fear. We must serve him. That's one of the ruachim of Yah, with fear and trembling. I come before him fearing, because I'm not trying to hide anything. And there are those that will complain with strangers against one that you have not even tried to learn. You haven't want to hear them. You're going to die that way. You can think what you want to, and no damn tears are going to bring you back. Get right with Yah. Undo it now. Let the word of Yahweh, Yahshua, show you how. Get right down at the altar and feel the drops of his dam. Get right with Yah. Let the Torah show you how. You must put on the bond of perfection and to love each other. Isn't it amazing, son? They can embrace the most degenerate haters of Yah, kiss them and love them, but they can't embrace you and hug you and kiss you. Mother can hug her daughter that's a flat-out whore. She can't hug you. She will look out for the dirty slut of a daughter. She won't look out for you. You don't have to tell me your stories. I know the nature of this generation. I care for the people of Yah. I do right by all men. I did right by that woman. Don't let your dog, I'm not going to let your dog slobber. I put a pair of slacks in the cleaner. I can wear them 10 times. I'm not going to let your dog the saliva of your dog put on me. So you, and even when I turn around, the dog come out. So I'm like, come on, dog. Don't put your foot on my dog. Lady, you don't know who you're dealing with now. You just don't know. I don't care if you're 99 or 109. That was a story old Bishop, Anderson told the story. See, there was this old woman. She had on pants and she had bags on. She got on the bus. She was limping, smoking a cigarette like a dragon. She got on the bus and the bus was full. She just waddling. Got a cigarette in her mouth, pants all on. See, there was a young man sitting there and she had to stand there. So she says to the young man, boy, you ain't gonna get up and get this mother that seat. He looks up at her and say, you're smoking like a man. You acting like a man and you dress like a man. You stand up like the rest of these men. Now that, well, he should have given it to her. Well, the old Jezebel, if she stopped smoking the cigarette, she could have probably caught a taxi home. How we want to justify the wicked, and we condemn the just. He that justified the wicked and condemned the just, even they both. If you even condemn the just, even they both is a to'eba, an abomination to Yah. You don't realize, and the reason we don't retain things because they have no value to us. When something has value to you, you remember that. But because it has no value, you forget it. You don't forget you got $300 under the mattress. That you don't forget that. And you check on that kind of periodically, don't you? I know I would. Listen to this, Yisraya. This is important. This is vitally important. And we must do this. You'll hear me? We must do this. Shaul writes unto the nation, the elect of Yah, here in 1 Corinthians. And he talks about a time whereby there is a change that must transpire in us. So when we hear the truth, the elect of Yah, we don't harden our hearts as in the days of provocation to provoke Yah. I know that there is a change when we see him. I know that has a spiritual connotation, implication. But it also have a transforming or a renewing of one's life in the natural realm. And he speaks unto us with preciseness, cohesiveness in 1 Corinthians 15, 53. Now, if you are in this state now, you're not going to find yourself. He that is filthy, when Yahshua comes, if you're filthy, let him be filthy still. You're going to be filthy when he comes. So he has entered into Yah's house today, his testimony witness. He says in 1 Corinthians 15, 53, this is when it's all is finished. At the end of the day, you say it's finished. And then you go into the dead state of mind. You die in your bed. You don't remember nothing for those 8-10 hours you slept. He says here in 1 Corinthians 15, 53, he tells us, for this corruption, this vile nature, must put on. We must destroy our flesh. We must put on that which is incorruption, incorruptible. That is the righteousness of Yah. That is the knowledge of Yah. You can't corrupt that because his word is forever settled in the heavens. So we have the power to take off and to put on. We can take off our corrupt nature and have the incorrupt nature of Yahshua by putting on what he commands us to put on. We must put on the invincible shield of Almighty Yah. We must put on righteous judgment and not judge partially. We must take off this corruption and put on incorruption. We must cease to live this mortal state, worry about the things that are natural, and put on the immortality to mind of Yahshua, because we're not worried about tomorrow. I'm not worried about today. I can't change nothing. I can't alter the weather pattern. I don't have the power to command me to breathe and not breathe. Because the life of Yah says, no, you can hold your breath. But I say, breathe. And you breathe. have no power. We put off this corrupt state and trust in the incorruptible mind of Yahshua that will not go against the commands, the mitzvot of Yah. It doesn't seek out its own way, as we were reminded during the feast of Yah. The way, Haderach. We put on the state of mind that we're not going to corrupt his commands, because we're going to live and not die. We're going to live and not die. We're going to be changed in that moment when he speaks to us. It changed our whole disposition. He says, when I speak to you, you don't harden your heart. Don't get up mad at the messenger. Get mad at you that defy you, that have disdain for him. You get mad at me. I don't care. It makes me no difference at all. Period. Don't write me, send me an offering today, all right? You have never sent an offering, but you're still there. Nothing changes. These folks are not even wicked. I will tell you a story. We had an old wicked boy. He was here with us. He called the police on me. I kicked him off. And all of a sudden, we start getting these offerings, $50, no address. I could see they were coming from North Carolina. So who was this? I knew who it was. I knew the pensmanship. Then the offerings went from $50 to $100, sometimes twice a week. It went from $100 to $200, $300, $500, $600. But the fool turned against me because I told him, I don't want any of your offerings. That's what I said. I'm not going to accept any of your gifts. Send them somewhere else. But I will never forget these other words that he spoke to me. He said, preacher, when I left you, I was going to prove that you were wrong. I went everywhere, and they were saying nothing. I was working, trying to hustle and make money. Couldn't make a dime. These were his words. He said, from the first offering I sent you, the whole paradigm, that was a shift. I began to get business. I began to make money. And so that's why the offering went from $50 the week, then the next week a 50 at the beginning, maybe 100 at the end. Then the next week maybe 200, and maybe at the end 100. Every week it went like that. What did you do? I knew who it was, but I didn't know. Because honestly, I would have sent the money back. Honestly, if I had to put an address on there, I would have sent it back. And the thing of it is, the person never wrote my name on it. I could cash all that for me. And over that nearly a year, the person sent about $15,000. That's how we pay for this land and that house next door to him. That's how we did it. Just honest. So you're not sending a dime. It doesn't alter anything. Send one, though. Hallelujah. Send one. You don't send a penny, it's not going to alter one thing at all. So when this corruption shall put on the incorruption, and the mortal shall have put on the immortality, then, shall be brought to pass the saying that is written, death is swallowed up in Teshua, in victory. Does that mean just to... I know he was talking about the catching away, the coming of Yahshua, but we should be caught up in him now. We should put off these corrupt deeds and actions that defy the state of Yah. We should put it off. Whether it be renewed in our minds. Lay hold unto the Yoshech, the great assurance of salvation of Almighty Yah. We must do that. We can't be up today and down tomorrow. We cannot be pretenders. You can't love me today with frivolity and falsehood. And then, as the old woman said, you would draw the dagger in my neck. Live honest with all men. I have nothing to hide. I have nothing to hide. Nothing. That's the honest truth. Then he says this. Death is swallowed up in this great victory. Does that have any implication as to me now? Or is that just in the day of his coming? I'm not going to preach all this today. I believe on Wednesday I will finish this, all right? Because it's a very powerful, yes, maybe Shabbat, who knows? I want to give us the great pronouncement of what Yahweh says here by the prophet Ezra, as he gives us knowledge and understanding of what he means here. Fourth Ezra, chapter 2 now. I want you to hear this in verse 45. Fourth Ezra, chapter 2, verse 45. The Melech, he answered and said to me, I want to go back now in 4th Ezra, chapter 2, verse 38. He tells us to whom to rise and stand at the feast of Yah, the number of those that have been sealed. So we that at Yah's great feast, as we come here on the Shabbaton, we feast on the lectrum of Yah in Yahshua. He tells us to rise, and then we allow ourselves to be sealed by the Ruach HaKodesh. I pointed out to us as a nation how that we must be sealed, Yisrael, by the Ruach of Almighty Yah. There's a process, there are elements that are pronounced in our lives that show us how we're sealed. We saw in Ephesians chapter 1:13, in whom, when you hear this truth, you began to trust. And you have heard the words of truth, the message of your salvation, and whom after also you believe, you were sealed. Yeah. Only after you believe this today that he is incriminating you, then are you sealed. The Ruach doesn't love that seep out of your mind. He doesn't love that to dissipate. He showed us that. And the process has been what we must put on. How we must dress. You know a filthy Jezebel by the way she dress. You know that. Not just her clothes, but her spirit and her mouth speaks. To let you know she's a Jezebel. You know a butch bulldog by the way she talks. She won't act like a man. You know an effeminate faggot boy when he tries to act like a woman. We have been sealed because we trusted. We believe because we have heard. And so we have been sealed with the Ruach HaKodesh of Yah in Yahshua. And we have confidence in what Yah is doing. Great confidence. And so the same Shaul tells us that we must put off this corruption. Our minds are in the constant bin of corruption. Come on, be honest with yourself. We do things that are so corrupt and we hide that. I want my sins to go before me. I don't want my sins to follow me. I don't want that. And we pretend we are right. Oh, I love you. You don't love me. You don't even love you. How can you love me when you don't love you? You don't even care about you. How can you care about me? And the only reason that others will stand by my wrong, it's because they got evil ways. They don't want them to be exposed. I expose me. I love me enough that I expose me. So their ways are so evil, they're not going to denounce my actions. They're not going to say anything because they know they're evil. And they don't want you to denounce theirs. So they know when you're coddling sin, they're not going to say anything because they're just as evil as you. He that knows to do right and doeth not, it is a sin. Yeah. You define that, you know what's right to do. Yeah. You don't do that, you're wrong. Yeah. We need men strong that stand up. We need the ish ruach in us as what we call men. Yeah. We need the physicality of Yahshua and the strength of Yahshua to stand. Yeah. Your mother, who is my, all of us, no. When he reached that age whereby he was ready to go, he said, woman, I must be about my father's business. He didn't call her mother. That's what he called her. That's a fact. I got to be about his business, so I'm about Yah's business. We must put off this corruption, this corrupt state of mind that twists Yah's word, justify the ultimate wickedness and sin without even conscience of the evilness of my ways. Something is twisted in me. You don't disperse that, or that does not dissipate from your spiritual mind. Just like a heroin addict that pours and get in him, there's a process of cleaning. You just don't overcome that overnight. There are agonies, there are pains, there are doubts, you're near death, there are tears, every kind of emotion, because your mind is messed up. You think the chemicals that a heroin addict use, or cocaine addict or crack addict, it doesn't mess up their minds and their physicality? You look at these boys that are on that methamphetamine, all their teeth are rotten, their bodies are broken, their minds are twisted, the women, their teeth are gone, their teeth are rotten, they, come on, lose their hair. And because we live in that sin, we lose our covering. We have no righteousness. A crackhead will lie for a dollar. Methamphetamine head will lie for a dollar. So we have no problem with lying and doing that which is evil and deceitful. And all the time they're killing themselves, are they not? They're not killing the crack dealer. They're not killing the heroin dealer. They're killing themselves. They will lie to get it. They will cheat. They will steal. And that's what we do to satisfy the own driving and the urgings of our flesh. We don't confront ourselves and say, I'm evil. I'm a crackhead. I won't deliver from this. We don't say that I do evil things. But you tell me how evil I am. I know there's nothing in me that's worth a dime. And I'm glad of that, because he paid the price. He paid it all for me. That's all that matters. He did it all for me. He did it all. There's nothing I can do. Nothing. He did it all. I'm so glad. I don't have no righteousness that I can rely upon. He has given me the prototype, what I must do to be like him. And he said, just let that same mind that was in me. I want that mind in you. We have to do right. We that are men here, whether you hear, you're listening, you have to do right. Brother called me and said, Raah, I've heard about the weather and all of that. What can I do? I'll come. You need help. You need assistance. I'm ready to come and leave. But well, we really don't need no leave in that regard. But I never mind help if you come to work. And work. Mm-hmm. I want you to work, though. We'll feed you well. I could always use some help. Because I see the things I need to do to get ready for next year. That building straight and paint. The next one and that one. The yard's beautiful. So this is how Yisrael, that we as a nation, we must trust. We have heard the words of truth. We have heard the message of Yeshua, in whom, after we've heard this, we believe we have been sealed now. We have been sealed with the Ruach of Emet. In Joel in Corinthians, he speaks profoundly. He speaks so indelibly with great wisdom. For we must put on this incorruptible state of mind that is in the knowledge of Torah, the wisdom of Torah. That's how we make ourselves incorruptible. Yeah. And Ezra, 4th Ezra, chapter 2, verse 45. When the Melach answered him concerning the great signs and the visions and those things that we shall see, listen to him. Same thing Shaul says here. He answered and said to me, beginning back at the first verse I read in 38. He answered and said unto me, these are they. These are they that have put off the mortal, the corrupt clothing. That's what he says. and 4 Ezra 2:45. Shaul says, for this corruption must put on incorruptible clothing. We must put off the mortal clothing. We must put off the clothing that are corrupt after our own sadistic evil ways. These are those that are sealed by the Ruach. They have cast aside their ways of the flesh. They have not given themselves over unto the corrupt things. They have put off the corrupt things. They have seen. They have been transformed in the moment when they heard the word of God. It has been a great blessing to the hearing. They have put off those mortal, the clothing that are corrupt. These are they who have put off the mortal clothing, and they have put on immortality. So don't tell me that means when we see Yahshua in the heavens, although it means that, it means that I look up and I see him every day. When I see the expanse of Yah's creation, by the power of his word, it makes me take off the filthy garments of my flesh that I've been spotted with my sins, and I put on the mortal garments. And so you get that by someone else, but you don't get it by me like that. Everything in this book is now. I'm not looking to the by and by. Now is the day of our Yahshua. So we hear the truth, we don't harden our heart. Not tomorrow. You better take off those mortal clothing. He told us what the clothing was. And you know you're fully dressed when you have that great Ruach of Yahshua, the great love of Yah. It perfects everything in you. That's why we have no perfect obedience. We have no perfect love for Yah. And that is what this, as he read to us at the end of the last great day, Yahshua stood up. Now he read that for the importance for us to hear. If any man thirsts, let him come and drink. We're not thirsty. We're parched, we're dried up because of our sins. In my days, when one was so corrupt, they would say, look at that boy, he's all dried up. They knew sin had dried him up. It will actually alter the appearance of one. One went away all healthy looking and all that, and sin had taken life out of them. I would hear the old people say that. I didn't understand that because I was a young boy. I wasn't even a lad. And they would say, oh, look at her. Oh, that sin of hers. Just done dried them up. No life in them. They would have no life in their facial. There was no joy. Your sin is corrupting the life and the witness of Yahshua. You want to blame me or someone else, but you're at fault, my friend. It's not anyone's fault. You have hardened your heart when you heard the truth, and you have not repented. And they would say, she looks so bad. She's all dried up. The skin doesn't look right. That's why when I was a lad, mammy, grandmammy, and all, they put that grease. They didn't put grease or oil. They didn't have no fancy Nivea cream or coconut oil. You had some of that poke fat. They will make that grease too, man. Gas hair will be down to their back. They have to have no extension in their head. And those mothers took care of their daughters. And grandma, they would call it rat vein grease. I remember this rat vein. And she would go there and get those that herb out of the woods. I remember that. And they were boiling. They didn't go down to CVS and buy grease. They made it right there. And gas the hair that long, and next thing you know, the little hair down their back. Platted and grass it up. Took care of them. Now this filthy generation gets some freak, some dog. False hair from India and all of that. The other hair's not going to grow. It's not going to come on. That's what they do. These old silly women out here. I'm not afraid to say that. I don't care who you are. Get the mess out of your head, woman. And let's all run those places. And faggots in there, men plaiting their hair and all that, women in every kind of sin there is. That's a fact. Listen to this. He answered and said to me, this is the message of Yah. These are they that have put off the mortar clothing. So if he saw them that had put off, he says, these are they. It is precise. That have put off. So we are the they that must put off these mortal affections that are against Yah. He's angry with the wicked every day. You have to be angry with your wickedness every day. They have put off the mortal clothing and put on the immortal. And when they do that, they began to confess the name of Almighty Yahweh. Praise the name of Yahweh, I will praise. We congregate with those that mock Yah's name. They laugh and they clown like jackasses. You don't talk about Yah, you talk about foolishness and worldly things. Everything I've talked about this week was Yah. Straighten this one out. No, you're wrong in that. Straighten that out. And they would always say, Raah, I appreciate your wisdom. Yah has blessed you. He has blessed me with that. I'm not going to regress on that or take that back. I don't care what men say. I don't care if you're young or old. You're silly if you don't see that. You got your dimension. Evangel Hartsfield used to tell me all the time, these men cannot top your shoelaces. I said, but they all have their gifts. I never boasted in that. He said, you say what you want to, but they don't even have the ability to articulate like you. So you got that gift. You got yours. Don't try to compare yourself with me. Don't try to do it like me. Just do it like me. You bring forth truth and righteousness. And so we got to take off these mortal clothing and put on the immortal clothing. And then we must confess the name of Yah. And we must confess the name of Yah now. Now they are being crowned. See, after you've done all that, then you receive the crown of life. That's when you receive it. Now they are being crowned. And they receive the Tehillim, the wisdom, the Psalms of Almighty Yah to satisfy their hearts, Yisrael. Now. So now is the acceptable day of Yah. You let Yah correct you and reprove you and correct you. And so at the next feast, you have already begun the farmers right now, they began to take care of the soil now for next year planting. They put the lime and all that out on the soil to make sure that the pH is balanced. So now you began to balance your life in truth and in the righteousness of Yah with great judgment. You began to balance yourself. So when you come to the Pesach of Yah, you can eat and not be sickly. You're not going to die in your sins. You can reject that all you want to, but it's to your death. It's to your death. That's what I got from it, daughter. I got that. I got that strength from all the teaching. Nigeria said, where were you? Well, I do things for a reason. I know what I'm doing. Poppy, where were you? I look for you. So the first thing she's going to look and see if the light's on. There's no lights on. I knew that. Just trust me to know what I'm doing, all right? I know what I do. You don't have to know the reason behind why I do things. I said to one, what happened to you? I said, I'll tell you one day. You'll understand what I tell you. Don't worry about it right now. You see, confidence and trust is a great thing. Because one day, as we're getting out of here, as I won't be around, one day as going home, be with my Yahshua, so as going to bless his name all the days of my life, and train you up in the way that you should go. You may not like it. You may get angry. Your disposition may change. That's all right with me. Because there's one that I must answer to. He will judge me impartially. Oh, he's a righteous judge. I must give everything that he has put in me. If I don't trust you today with her nefesh today, I cannot trust you because eyes I won't be here. So I must trust you with honor and integrity. I know what I'm doing. I don't care if you don't understand. And I won't even answer you, not today, but I answer you. By and by, you will understand. You'll know the reason behind everything I do. You just mock that man that loves Yah-Rabbah. You will see him in the shalom of Yah. He is broke as a skunk, but he is all right. I don't have a dime today. I don't have no money for me. I got no change in my bag, but if I go out and see something you're like, I get it. I got $30 left, baby. I spend it on us. That's what I do. That's what I do. Hallelujah. I want to close with this. And this will take us into the next teaching, what I want to. This is part one. The final determination and the finish line. Ezra 2, 4th Ezra chapter 2. I started at 38. I want to read verse 40. Yah is so precise. He says to the prophet, he told him to take your gan. You make sure you're right. He is so right. He said, your full number, O Zion, and reach a final determination. It is the finish. Reach a final determination. Those are your people who are clothed in white, who have fulfilled the Torah of Yah. You can pretend all you want to, my friend, and say you're fulfilling the Torah of Yah. It's woe unto you, unto your own destruction. The Nobi Yochanan says, I looked. He says, and lo, a lamb. He stood on the same place that Ezra was. Sion, Zion. He stood on Mount Zion. He said, and with him, 144,000. He says, Revelation 14:1, with their father's name written in their forehead. I read to us in 4th Ezra 2:45. He answered and said to me, these are they that have put off the mortal clothing and put on the immortal garments, and they have confessed the name of Yahweh. He said, I saw them that had this name. This is the seal house of Yisrael. He gives us a pattern of the birthright of those and the example that must be personified among us. He said, I saw the name of those and the father's name, Hatab, written in the Rush. And I heard a voice from the heavens as a voice of many Mayim, and the voice of great thunder, and the voice of the harp, and the voice of the harps. And they began to make Hiram a song, as it is were a renewed song, before the throne of Yah and before the four beasts. And the elders said, no man can learn this. You don't learn this truth. You're taught this truth. And no man could sing it but the 144,000 which were redeemed from the earth. And this is the pattern of those. These are they which have not defiled themselves with this religious whoredom. and the spirit of this age and the lies and the corruption. You cannot defile yourself, Yisrael. They have not defiled themselves. And he give us a reading of all of those that will come to that great knowledge. He saw Melach. I want to read this. Do other scripture before I close. He said, I saw this Melach. Hold up. He said, and these are those that have not defiled their garments with woman, for they are virgins. They have not given themselves over to the world. They have not been a part of the mortal corruption of the world. He said, they are they which follow Yahshua wheresoever he goes. These were redeemed from among men, being the first fruit of Yah, and to the Lamb Yahshua. And in their mouth was found no guile. I just taught on that recently, didn't I? We have this guile and the lies of corruption. You know, you have the subtlety of Ashata. They had no guile, for they are without fault before Yah and before the throne of the Most High. And he said, I saw this messenger with the voice flying in the midst of Hashemam. He had the everlasting, it says that, the Le'olam. Revelation 14:6, he had the everlasting message. This is what I teach you today. It is the Le'olam V'ad, to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation, and every kindred, and every tongue, and every people. And I speak with a loud voice, Skara, saying with a loud voice, I command us to fear Yah, Yira, Yire, fear Yah, and give honor to him, to his name. For the hour is come of his judgment. He's judging us. We better start giving honor and fear Yah and fear the death of that sin in us. Yeah. Fear Yah, for the hour of his judgment is come, and Shecha, fall prostrate. We must honor him that made the heavens and the earth and the sea and the fountains of water. That's what we must do. Yeah. Only a few in Zion. Close with this last verse from 4 Ezra 2:40. Take you the full number, and did not Yochanan have the full number? 12,000 from every tribe? Did he not have the full number? We must take the full number, O Zion, and reach a final determination. It's finished. Those of your people, we must be clothed in the tzaddik and the righteousness who have fulfilled the Torah of Almighty Yah. The word fulfill, it is the kalah, it is determination, it is the finished work of Torah. We must. He says in Revelation 3:4, hear this, among even us, among you that are listening, you have a few names, even in Sardis, which have not defiled their garment. It's not many. He reminds us that few there be that find it. They have not defiled their garments, done wickedly. You have a few names among you. They have not defiled their garments, and they shall walk in the white. Why? Yah says they are worthy. Yeah. Worthy is the Lamb. Make me worthy, Yah. Yeah. I will conclude this in Yah's time, maybe Wednesday or next week. The determination, which is the final, the finish of it all. We must finish. We must fight the battle of Emunah. How precious it is to die in the faith. We can't talk this, son. We got to walk it. You can't be a hypocrite. You can't talk this. You got to walk this. You can't compel me to do something. You're not doing it. You can't get up and rebuke me and you're a flat out liar. You got to walk this. Not only do you walk this or talk this, you got to live this. It must be the cloak of your clothing. We must put this on. And you can only put it on when you get the knowledge and understand. You got to walk this talk. You got to live this talk. You just can't talk it. It has to reflect Yahshua. May the riches of Yah rest upon you all. Yahshua's name, you are friends, our enemies. We greet you all. We're glad that you're here with us today. May Yah continue to strengthen you. You that are in great need of agony, your pain. As the old one would say, just put it in Yah's hands. There's nothing you're going to do. You've prayed and you've prayed about it. Even if I pray for you today, you still haven't put it in Yah's hands. Put it in Yahshua's hands. He will make it all right. That's why you pray, and your prayers are repetitive. Yahshua didn't pray repetitive unto the Abba. He said the third time, it be done. Not my will, but your will be done. It's settled in me. So once it gets settled in you, you don't pray every day and all during the day for your sons, your daughters, that y'all save them. We must put it in his hands. He is the master of all things. You must put it in his hand. We put it in every hand. You put it in your hands and it has not produced anything. You've gone your way and it hasn't produced anything. You haven't turned anyone around because you haven't turned you around. So put it in Yah's hand. He will make it all right. He will make it all right. And whatever he does, it's all right. It's all right. It's all right. It's all right with me, whatever he does. Whether he gives me life or he calls me home today. I don't care if you get upset. May the riches of Yah rest. Let us stand to our feet. Let me dismiss. Hallelujah. Bless you all today. My friends and enemies, in all things, we do Baruch, Yah and Yeshua's name, bless you for all things. Bless us all, go with us, guide us. Bless the table today and give us wisdom and strength. In Yeshua's name, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.